where you were.
Okay, so it is really hard for me to stand behind a podium, so you'll probably see me drifting further. Don't let me do that. Just kick me back. So I love ears, and I did a scientific study at my desk one day, and I decided that Microtia and Aural Atresia kids are my favorite because they're the cutest, they're the smartest, and they're just more fun than all the other kids in the world. So for a living, I look in ears. I put stuff on kids' heads. As you know, this is not what I do. This is what I do. Kids don't necessarily love it when you poke at them. So my job can be a little bit more difficult than others. And I, generally speaking, don't sedate children. So I get them wide awake and fighting, which is super fun for everyone. So we're going to go over several things today. I'm going to kind of go over how hearing works, how to read your child's audiogram, what that means, and what are some considerations to think about when we're thinking about hearing, what we can do for hearing, and what are some options that you and your family can decide for your children. I am not here, just like Dr. Lewin said, to tell you what to do, what not to do. I just want to give you some options, and we can think outside the box together. I'm obviously available, and you can grab me, and we can chat about your specific situations anytime, okay? So get ready, turn up the speed of your ears because this is going to be fast. How does hearing work? Well, a sound wave comes in the ear, the eardrum moves, the ossicle pushes the oval window moves, it moves the fluid in the cochlea moves the outer hair cell movement causes the electrical stimulation of the hearing nerve, and the nerve sends a message to the brain for stimulation. That happens like that. Okay, so there's a lot of places where this can go wrong. What my job is to find out what area of the ear the problem is and therefore help you guys figure out what the best intervention is for your child. So like we talked about before, there are three major divisions of the ear. We have a laser pointer. We have your outer ear here, which is your ear canal, most importantly, where you put your earrings. Your eardrum is kind of the wall to the middle ear. The middle ear is where all those cute, adorable little middle ear bones live. And then your inner ear, which is the guts, the glory, the important parts. That's where the nerves and all those little baby hair cells that do all the hard work every day, that is where they live, okay? Your children more than likely have a problem in the outer and or middle ears. So that's kind of what we're gonna focus on today. Now, when we test hearing, there's a couple things we have to do to decide where the hearing loss is. We do what's called air conduction testing. Air conduction testing takes sound from outside the ear, like a headphone, and puts it all the way through the system. That tells me, on a day-to-day basis, just like I'm talking to you right now, we are talking through air conduction, what can go from outside all the way in. Now, that's all well and good, but for your kiddos, there's gonna be hearing loss there, right? I need to find out what the organ of hearing, the guts, the glory, what that hears. So in that instance, we're going to test what's called bone conduction, and we're specifically testing the inner ear at that point. How we test bone conduction is we put this little metal headband on. There's a little box on it that vibrates. That vibration shakes the skull, not like a, you know, shakes the skull, which in turn shakes the fluid inside the cochlea, which makes those little baby hair cells move and sends that message to the brain. If all goes according to plan, that is completely normal. I have to do both kinds of tests, air conduction and bone conduction, to see where the problem is. Okay, so like I said before, conductive hearing loss, that's what we're gonna focus on. Like I said, inner ear, completely normal, or bone conduction, completely normal, and then we see a problem in the outer or middle ear. Mixed loss, this too can happen in a kiddo with Microtia and Aural Atresia. This basically is a combo. This means there's a problem in the outer and or middle ear and on the inner ear. But the inner ear is not as bad as it could be, okay? So it's a little bit in the inner ear, a little bit on the outer and middle. Sensory neural loss is, again, possible, but more than likely not what we're gonna have here. Sensory neural loss is a problem of the inner ear. So when we test air conduction and bone conduction, they're gonna match up perfectly, telling us that the only problem is that inner ear. So this is your kid. You have the happiest little inner ear I've ever seen in my life. And as an audiologist, if I could pick a hearing loss for your kid, I'd pick this every time. Because the guts are good. The important part is good. We just got to get the sound to it. So, way to go for picking the right kind of hearing loss to have. Good job, mom and dad. This is what we call an audiogram of familiar sounds. Sometimes we refer to it as a speech banana. Guess why? There's a big banana in the middle of the thing. But this is a pictorial representation of an audiogram. Now, an audiogram is how we chart hearing. It goes from low, grumpy pitches all the way up to high, squeaky sounds, and very, very soft sounds to very, very loud sounds. Now, as an audiologist, we test all the different pitches or frequencies, and we see how loud does a sound have to be in order for your child to hear it 50% of the time. 50% of the time is what we call the hearing threshold. So we look for the thresholds at all these different pitches. What is so great about this is you can't see sound. It makes my pictures on my presentation not as cool as everybody else's because it's really hard to put sound on a slide. But in this instance, we can. So this is basically saying, let's see a good sound here. Like the G here. G is at approximately, and it's not G, that's not a G, that's a G. A G is approximately at 2,000 hertz at 40 decibels, okay? So as you can see, the different speech sounds are all over this graph, they're not clustered in one spot. So it's possible that your child may be able to hear some sounds better than others, which is super. When we chart things on an audiogram, we're looking at what is called the air conduction. Again, what we're hearing all the way through the system. When we put these marks on the graph to tell you how much hearing loss there is, I look at the air conduction thresholds. When we put marks on the graph, anything above the marks means you can't hear it. Anything below the marks means you can, okay? This here, let's assume that all these marks here are at that 40 decibel mark. Well, with 40 decibel hearing loss, you're only really hearing about 50% of the speech sounds, okay? This is something audiologists love to hate. This is called, this is how we classify hearing loss. We call it degree of hearing loss. Why we love to hate it is, yes, it's great to be able to say, this person has a moderate sensory neural hearing loss. It's a nice little concise way to say something, but what does moderate mean? We're most concerned with the word mild, because you think mild, you're like, no big. Mild, I got a mild cut, I have a mild cold, no big deal, I'll be fine. A mild hearing loss, it's what we saw on this graph before. A mild hearing loss goes up to this 40 decibel mark, and like I said before, only 50% of the speech sounds can be heard with a mild loss. That would be the maximum mild loss. So these descriptive words are a little not as great as I want them to be. Okay, but they're what we have and what we use. So just know when you hear the term mild, moderate, whatever, that really it's not the best descriptor, and you should really look at that chart to see what all they're missing. When we're looking at an audiogram for your kiddos especially, we're gonna look at the bone conduction. That's what that inner ear, the guts, the glory, what that actually hears. When we look at bone conduction for one of your kiddos, we're looking at the actual potential of hearing that this child may have. Be that with a bone conduction device, a canaloplasty, an FM system, something, what is the possible hearing this child could have? Now, bone conduction in your kiddos more than likely is normal. So I kind of look at the gap between the bone conduction and the air conduction to tell me how much sound is possible to get. This is another audiogram. This is what you'd kind of typically see. I made this on Excel, so it looks a little silly, but it's the best that I could do on Excel. This is something you'd typically see for a kid who has a unilateral loss. The left ear here is these little blue X's here. And this is at 10 decibels across the board, which is normal hearing. So in this example, we have a normal hearing left ear. On your kiddo, this is probably their open ear if this is a unilateral loss. The red, where's my pointer? The red down here, it goes from a 50 to a 70. That's a moderate to severe loss. This is your kiddo's microtic and atretic ear. That's all well and good. What does that mean? We have a normal hearing left ear and we have a moderate to severe hearing loss in the other ear. On a day-to-day basis, what does that mean? Do they have a hearing loss? Yes. Are they normal hearing? Yes. That's confusing. But it's true. So on a typical day-to-day, your kiddo with one open ear that has normal hearing is gonna do just fine, okay? We look now at the bone conduction results. That's these little triangle-y guys here. That's normal. That's saying that we have a normal inner ear on that side, okay? So depending on your child, this could be just fine. And they could go about their day and learn speech and language and do excellent in school and just rock out for the rest of their lives and they might be fine. Some kids, on the other hand, with this kind of hearing loss may need help. The problem with kids, and I guess it's not the problem with kids, it's the problem with what we do to our kids. We put our kids in the crummiest listening environments ever. Have you ever been in an elementary school before? Worst. You got kids tapping things and doing stuff, which is not great. And then we have teachers who talk to the chalkboard all day, which is not good. So sometimes these kiddos with a unilateral loss are gonna need a little help because we're making one ear work like two. And what the biggest problem is for kiddos with a unilateral hearing loss is speech and noise. So I'm the speech, y'all are the noise, the air conditioner's the noise, you doing stuff is the noise, everything else in the world is the noise, okay? So if we're having problems, I'm gonna talk today about what we can do. Now you can choose to do something before you know your kid has problems, you can do it after, you can do it anytime you want, anything is fine. You know your kid, I don't. So you tell me what we need to do and I'll help you make decisions along the way, okay? So again, this is another example. This is your Microtia and Aural Atresia kiddo. If you're bilateral, that's what you look like. We definitely need help if you're bilateral. If you're bilateral, none of this stuff I'm saying at the end means anything because you're getting something for your ear, okay? Okay. So unfortunately, and Dr. Kess and I were just talking about this, unfortunately we have brains. If we just had ears, my life would be so easy. But unfortunately, we have brains, and brains make life complicated. If we have normal hearing in both ears, if our ears are just exactly the same in both ears, your brain is gonna tell you that you only hear a sound in the sound that in the ear that it's loudest. So if someone yells at me from over in this corner, I know they're over in this corner because it's louder in this ear. It's called the head shadow effect. Your head casts a shadow, not a light shadow, a sound shadow, because all sound is vibration. The vibration smacks you in the head and it doesn't go through as well to the other ear, okay? It still gets there, but just not as loud and with less intensity. So we have what's called the head shadow effect. This is, again, how we are able to localize sound. Why is this important? Who cares? Me. Because your kid doesn't know when a car is coming from this way if they only hear in this ear. If a dog is barking and chasing them, they don't know that it's coming from over here when they only have good hearing in this ear. So your kid's gotta use a whole lot more cues, like their eyes, like their other senses, to know where sound is coming from. Some people don't have a problem with this at all, some people do. So in your kiddo that does have a hearing loss in one ear, your brain, again, only hears the sound in the better hearing ear. So if we have a hearing loss in this left ear here, the sound is gonna be louder and the right side, the localization is gonna be off. Okay. Oh, one more thing. Can we do something about this? Possibly. Bone conduction devices are great, but again, if the hearing in the ears isn't exactly the same, it's gonna be harder to localize, and we'll talk about that. So some things we can do about this are a canaloplasty. Canaloplasties are great. They basically given you an ear hole, which is lovely. Your canal looks like your canal for a reason. If you look to your left, look to your right, if the people to your left and your right have canals. They're fairly similar. They have a nice little bend in them. All that is great because the sound goes in there and those little curves and bends amplify sound and give us normal hearing ears. Canals that look different, we may not get normal hearing. So when you go to have a consultation about a canal, if it's something you want, I want you to ask some questions so you know what you're looking for, what you're getting into. So could there be hearing loss after surgery? We just talked about this. Anyone that guarantees you'll have normal hearing, where in that worries me. So let's talk about that with your surgeon before. Ask to see before and after audiograms with children of good and poor results. It's fine to ask. Knowledge is power. Cosmetics, ask to see some excellent results and some poor example photos both before and after surgery. Upkeep of the canal, will it need to be cleaned out? Is that painful? Collapse, ask about failure, cave-in, water considerations. How will it be with swimming, bathing? Does that increase the rates of infection? Will there be pain with wind, cold, air, water? Now, these are all just great questions to ask. Different surgeons will have different answers for these things. So I want you to find a specialist who can answer all your questions so you can make a right decision for your kid. Some of these things are not a big deal at all, and the benefits far outweigh the other, but it's all good. I'm all for canaloplasties. So if we have a canaloplasty or if we don't, doesn't matter. You can get a bone conduction processor anytime you want. You can get it the day of birth if you want. You can wait till the child has a med pour, has a rib repair, anything, and you can get a conductor then. Doesn't matter. This isn't any time kind of deal. So these processors were traditionally used for conductive hearing losses due to the outer and middle ears, fluctuating mixed or conductive hearing losses, patients with constant drainage from the ears. She can't put a baby computer in an ear that's all squishy, not good, or single-sided deafness. Here's some examples of what these processors can look like, and they can be coupled to the head in very different ways. You can have your soft, stretchy headbands like this. This is a cochlear Baja. The headbands are great for kiddos, and especially if you don't want to have surgery for an implant or your child's just not ready for that. You can also get a metal headband. It's up to you. Either one is great. There is the metal post implants. Right here is an Oticon Ponto, and that's coupled to the head with a metal abutment. And then the implanted transdermal magnets, this is a siphono, which is coupled to the head with a magnet. Now, what transdermal means is there's a magnet under the skin, there's skin on top, and then your device goes over. There's a lot of considerations when you guys are trying to figure out which kind of device or which kind of coupling to the head is right for you. Okay, some of these things can be prepared, compared really well. Some of them can't just because of the nature of the devices. But there's some things that we can talk about here. So traditionally, only things connected with magnets were for sensory neural losses like the cochlear implant, which I'm sure if you've ever said your child has a hearing loss, somebody has said to you, get a cochlear implant. And you're like, yeah, Mike, that's not good. That's not what my kid needs. So people think that that's a quick fix for everything, but luckily you guys have the great kind of hearing loss where you have the guts, the glory, the good stuff in the middle, so you don't need that kind of cochlear implant. But like I said, transdermal magnets, that's happening now. The great thing about those magnets is they can be adjusted. The stickiness of the magnet can be adjusted to best suit your needs. So Cochlear Baja does a great example on their website of comparing the two things. This came directly off of their website. The Baja is the only one I could really compare here because they do both the metal abutment and the magnet. I'd love to be able to compare the Oticon Ponto and the Sifono as well, but with every device, there's different processing strategies, different circuitry, stuff like that, so it'd be really comparing apples to oranges. They do a really great job of comparing these things so you guys can make a good decision. The traditional post-implant gives a maximum hearing performance and it gives 10 to 15 dB better hearing than the magnet. Now, why is that? Well, with the post, there's direct contact with the skull. The post is put directly in the skull and the device is put directly on the post, straight through. The magnet, on the other hand, has that skin in between. The skin will absorb some of that vibration from the device. The pressure from the magnet can cause skin breakdown. Sure, it can, but like I said before, the magnet can be adjusted and the stickiness of the magnet can be changed if you are having any kind of problem. Magnets have been used for a long time, like I said, with cochlear implants, and this usually isn't the hugest problem. If the patient is a person who will need MRIs, the magnet is not advised as the implant needs to be visible. Now, can you get MRIs with the magnet? Absolutely, yes, you can. I think they're referring to more people that are gonna have like kind of chronic MRIs, but you can absolutely get an MRI with the magnet. For patients who retention is a priority or have an active lifestyle, the magnet's not advised. If you are jumping out of airplanes and you are boxing, I do not think a magnet is right for you. If you are playing basketball with your friends in the yard, go for it. So these are just things to consider. This is not saying that every child that runs through a yard has an active lifestyle, okay? These are more. These magnets stay pretty darn well, okay? Now, there's other things out there other than bone connection devices that can help your child hear. The great thing about assistive listening devices are you can have a bone conduction device, you cannot have a bone conduction device, you can have a canaloplasty, you cannot have a canaloplasty, all these things will help you. An assistive listening device is anything other than a hearing aid that helps a person function normally on a day-to-day basis due to problems associated with hearing loss. You might see this sign, this is the international symbol for an ALD, the writing might not be there, but that ear with the line through it will be. Movie theaters, places where there's like plays or performances, a lot of these places are wired so that there is a device that can help a person with hearing impairment. Next time you go to the movies with your kid, ask them if they have any kind of assistive listening device. More than likely they will, okay? It's just something that usually people don't talk about, don't know about. Other examples of assistive listening devices are ALDs. First of all, who lives in Southern California? Okay. Cool. And all of you people somewhere else. Okay. First one we're going to talk about is the shake awake alarm clock. That is this. Southern California people are laughing, and I know why. The shake awake alarm clock is awesome. All these things here, first of all, they build independence, and that's exactly what we want. We want our children to move out of the house when they're 18. We do not want to keep them forever, right? This is a way to do this. Now, the shake awake alarm clock is really cool. I highly recommend it. It's a regular alarm clock on top, and then there's this little wire, which in real life is a lot longer than this, and then this little button thing. That little button goes underneath your mattress. If you live in Southern California, this will not work for you, and let me tell you why. When your bed shakes, you're gonna wake up and say, that was a 3.1, who cares, go back to bed. If you live in Ohio, you will jolt out of your bed so quickly you will not know what hit you because you think that there is the biggest earthquake that has ever happened, ever, okay? Southern California people, turn it up, make it a 7.2. Ohio people, turn it down, all you need is a 2.0, okay? So this is different depending on the region you live in. Don't be concerned, you're fine. TV ears, this is the TV ears right here. This thing looks like it was, in the 1980s because it was built in the 1980s. And that's okay because it still really works and it's still really good. So there hasn't been a lot of new developments on the TV ears because the original was pretty darn good. What you do is you put this little box at the bottom by your TV, you put these little thingies on your ears and the person with the hearing impairment can hear without blasting everyone else in the room with the TV. It's a good deal. TTY, that's what this little guy is. So this is kind of confusing to explain, but it's really great. If you're a bilateral person, I totally recommend this. If you're a unilateral person, put it on your good ear, you'll be fine. A TTY, most of these phones are free. So if this is something you're interested in, look them up, you can get them for free. The TTY uses what's called a relay system. So it's a state-funded program where there's when you're talking to someone, there's three people in your conversation, not two. If I am hearing impaired and I want to call Dr. Lewin, what I do is dial her number, she picks up the phone, and that relay service in the middle says, hi, my name is Jenny, and I work for the California Department of typing stuff on a phone. And then Dr. Lewin says, cool, that's great. And how it works is Dr. Lewin will talk, and the person in the middle will type everything she says, and it will come across this little screen here so I can read what Dr. Lewin is saying. Now, if my speech is easily understandable, sometimes it is, sometimes it's not, I can just talk back to her. Now, if I'm bilateral, perhaps, or I am really needed to beef up my speech therapy, I can type whatever I want. The relay service person will speak it to Dr. Lewin. She may speak back, and they will type back to me. So this is a great service for people who are deaf or hard of hearing. And again, freebies, yay. So there's also visual alerting devices like baby monitors. You've seen the baby monitors with the lights that show you. Now there's like video baby monitors, which are even cooler. Doorbells, this is cool. I used to have a sign language teacher. She was hearing, her husband was, he was deaf, but hearing impaired nonetheless. And when we'd ring her doorbell, all her lights in her house would flash. That was to tell her, hey, check the door. They also had a dog. So you've heard of seeing eye dogs. Well, they had a hearing ear dog. This dog was not professionally trained. This dog's just really smart and figured out who was hearing impaired and who wasn't. If she was home, somebody would knock on her door. The dog would look at her like, whatever. If he was home and somebody knocked on the door, the dog would go get him and bring him to the door. So that's cool. Go get one of those. Bluetooth connectivity. Everything we have now, you can connect Bluetooth. I saw a hairbrush the other day that was connected. I don't know what it's connected to, but whatever. If you, everything you can do Bluetooth now, your cars, anything, and that's all very helpful for those that are hearing impaired. Now, the most common ALD is called a FM system. You might be familiar with an FM system because we're using one right now. An FM system, the transmitter, that, picks up the signal, that, and transmits it via radio waves to the receiver, which is probably over there in that corner, and that delivers the sounds to these lovely speakers that are in the ceiling and around and everywhere, okay? Love them, they're great. If your child has an FM system at school, your child should be the most popular person in school. Let me tell you why. Teachers love FM systems. They love them so much they forget to turn them off. A teacher will walk out into the hallway at school, tell her teacher friend, oh yeah, little Johnny, he spit on a classmate and he said a bad word and he's getting detention tonight. Well, that just went directly in your kid's ear, who is in the classroom. So your kid walks out and says, yo, Johnny's getting detention, what? So your kid should be very popular because he knows all the dirt. That's good. I am for your child using anything they can to their advantage. Go for it. Now, there's also a downfall. Your teacher will go out into the hallway and tell her teacher buddy, oh my gosh, I went to Metallica concert last night. We brought it and it was amazing. Your kid's gonna hear that too. Your teacher is also eventually, sometime in the school year, going to have to use the bathroom. She or he will forget to turn off their FM system. Your child is gonna be sitting in class going, where is that water coming from? And then they're gonna hear, whoosh! Then they're gonna know, okay? So good with bad, do what you gotta do, make it happen. So FM systems are very versatile. You can use them a bunch of different ways. They can be ear level worn as a standalone device, connected to a device using a boot, or built into the hearing device, or used with a speaker allowing a group to hear. That's what we're doing right now. The transmitters look very different. Right now we're using a mic like this. But these are the kinds, these are mostly from a brand called Phonak. Odegaard has some great products out there for FM systems. Other companies do too. I would say that most school systems use Phonak products. That's just what I've seen in my experience working with schools. So I thought I'd show you some, just the ones you might see most commonly. This is on this little part up here. This is a necklace that goes around that you can adjust the height of it. If your teacher is wearing their microphone here, this is what your kid is hearing. Put your microphone here, okay? If there's a lapel mic that is on the belt, your child's hearing your teacher's belt, which is maybe not the most interesting point that they could be learning about. So this is a necklace system. This is a regular microphone. A lot of times you'll see these in the middle of conference tables. And then down here, this is something, this part clips on your belt, and this is like a little lapel mic. These are great. Again, got to put them near their lapel. That's why they're called a lapel mic. The receivers, these are cool. This is what you'll see a lot of times with bone conduction devices. Those three little prongs clip into the device. Sometimes there's also built-in ones. Like this is a traditional hearing aid with a built-in FM. Now these down here, these are cool. Okay, so let's say you don't want to do a canal. Let's say you don't want to do a bone conduction device. Does that mean you can't have any amplification? No, of course not. What's really cool about these is this can go, if you're a unilateral person, this can go in your open ear. So you're giving that extra boost of sound to the open ear. Now, let's say you get a canal, but your hearing isn't exactly as normal as you want it to be, or you need a little boost in that canal ear. That's fine too. You can put one of these in a canal ear, which is great. So, yay FM systems, I'm all for it. Great, B, you told me to get all this stuff. How do I get it? How do I pay for it? That's when lovely insurance companies come into play. So insurance coverage for hearing aids and devices, obviously, just like anything else, varies from plan to plan. It can be a percentage of the total cost, a lump sum of money. Like my little cousin Lexi, I diagnosed her hearing loss 4 years ago. This is her insurance plan. She gets $5,000 for 3 years, and then at 3 years, that $5,000 starts over. Coverage for care and follow-up of a device, but not actual equipment or hearing aid, no coverage at all, or full coverage. Now, bone conduction implants and insurance. If you're doing an implant, a magnet, whichever, if there's a surgery involved, as long as your surgeon orders all the pieces, that includes the device, the implant part, all of that, at once, it's generally speaking covered under surgical billing codes, and you're not going to have a single problem with this. The surgeon should order everything all at once and give your audiologist the device. Now, if that doesn't happen, and you have to order it separately or like a soft band, you can have durable medical equipment coverage. This usually is a bank of money. Now, a bone conduction aid is generally speaking a DME code, so it's not a hearing aid code, but sometimes you can get hearing aids and FM systems covered under DME or hearing aid coverage, just depending, okay? So, that's me, I'm B. Come find me afterwards, we can talk about your needs, and we'll do questions with Dr. Kestner.